I actually ate some very, very good chicken today. But you know, on that note, let's segue back into the movie. Because you know, what we're going into is the aesthetics. You guys know what aesthetics are?
Visual
What's aesthetic?
aesthetic?
What does aesthetic mean, Nebby?
Visual appearance.
Exactly. That's actually what it means. I'm proud of you. So in this case, we're going to be looking at the cinematography, the editing, and just the directing overall. I don't have much written for here. I have a few points. But as before, this is Martin Felix Scorsese. Is that his middle name?
Scorsese.
Martin Scorsese. What's his middle name? Anybody want to guess the man's middle name?
Jennifer.
Martin Marc Antonio Luciano. Martin Marc Antonio Luciano Scorsese.
Luciano.
So, I'm gonna leave this up to any of you want to start on the aesthetics and just how you feel about it overall, anything that stood out in particular?
So like, can you explain it again? Sorry, I thought you were going to explain it.
Oh, I mean, I can. I can start off, it's fine. So pretty much just like all the Billy, you're in film class, all the stuff that we talk about in film class, the cinematography, you know, the shots, all that stuff, shot angles, your composition of your framing is any extreme long shots, close-ups, you know, stuff like that, the camera movements, you know, stuff like that, the editing, which I'll probably like to talk about the editing because some great editing here, and the directing in general, and how that influences all of that. So I know none of us have seen Dances with Wolves, correct?
Correct.
How, I know this is kind of arbitrary question, like on a scale of 1 to 10, how amazing does the directing in Dances with Wolves, or like just like the overall aesthetics, because that's the category. The aesthetics of Dances with Wolves have to be to surpass, to like convince you that Kevin Costner, who was the director of that movie, deserved the Oscar over Martin Scorsese. On a scale of 1 to 10, how good does that have to be? Just to,
Wait, first, can you tell me the genre of this movie?
I think it's like a historical epic.
Historical epics. Favorite movies.
It is a Western and a drama. Western slash drama. It's 4 hours long.
Me?
But
No, I can't think of anything.
okay.
Sorry.
Just like think of it, just like or just like something simple, like a single word. Just like does it have to be like a whole bunch of, what am I mean? You can't like just think on a scale of 1 to 10. Just how great does the directing in that have to be to really surpass this? To surpass what Scorsese did here? Is it like a 3 is like just simply, it doesn't have to be super great. If it's good enough, that means it's just easily surpassed it because the directing here isn't great. If it's a 5, it's like, okay, it has to at least be average because this is average. And if it's like a 10, this is amazing. So it has to be amazing too. It has to be all-time great. Kind of like on that scale, Nebby, if you understand what I'm saying, do you have a answer?
What's the question?
On a scale of 1 to 10, the movie that won Best Director this year is Dances with Wolves.
This year?
No, not this year, but like 1990, the year 1991, the year the Goodfellas lost. How great does the directing in that have to be to convince you that Dances with Wolves deserved it?
Oh, we're on directing now.
I mean, we're just on aesthetics in general. You just, okay, forget directing. How well does the aesthetics, the cinematography, the editing, and the directing overall have to be on a scale of 1 to 10 to convince you it's better than Goodfellas?
Simply put, it's gotta be nothing below an 8. Simply
Okay.
that. I mean, maybe even, I mean, aesthetics wasn't really, I guess, like, the main focus of this movie, if I do say so myself.
Nebby, like, leave. Be gone, thought.
Aesthetics.
No, I really, really disagree. Goodfellas is known as one of the greatest achievements in editing ever, and the greatest achievements with cinematography. That's all aesthetics. In cinematography. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, I can see. Oh,
dude, can you see this?
The cinematography. Oh, shoot. I was
cinematography, directing, and editing. Does that help?
Oh, even directing.
Yes, it's the aesthetics of all overall. Just like aesthetics is the visual beauty. The directing is incorporated in that. The cinematography is incorporated in that. And the editing is incorporated in that. The directing goes into the set design, the costume design, all of that. That we don't have to get too much into the technicalities. But I think what you said is like right along the lines. It has to be at least an 8 out of 10. Like Dances with Wolves has to be amazing to convince you that it's better than this, right?
Well, not because I was really just talking. I thought you meant like scenery and like colors as an aesthetics, but
I mean that is a part. That itself is the cinematography.
Okay, so I don't know. What are your thoughts on the directing and editing, though? Like, what scenes stand out to you?
Well, I guess I'll go there. All right, so okay, talking about just directing, the first thing I wanted to talk about is. Funny how we talked about how that's not in the script. And I'm going back to another movie from Mr. Scorsese, Wolf of Wall Street, Billy.
See.
And Nevi doesn't get that. Nevi doesn't get that. Billy, that was not in the script at all. Like, not even close to being in the script of the Wolf of Wall Street.
Really? I was like, what the hell is that? Like,
what happened was Matthew McConaughey, that is his normal everyday routine. When he's going out, that is what he does to get his to make sure that his voice is low enough. And you know, he has the Matthew McConaughey voice. It's a way to calm himself, right? Mm-hmm. And Leonardo DiCaprio, they shot the scene. They didn't have that. Leonardo DiCaprio saw that was happening. He was like, hey Martin, can we try that out? Martin Scorsese, bet. Ended up putting that into the movie. Similarly, same thing with the funny housing. Nowhere in the script, Joe Pesci was like, yo, there's this experience I had in my actual life. Can we add that? Martin Scorsese, sure. That, I think, is a pro of this guy. Where there are a good amount of directors who are a bit too self-indulgent. Well, they would not allow for that to happen. Imagine a world where we don't have the funny house scene. Imagine a world where we don't have and it's a different world. So I think just those itself, the ability for him to...
Y'all hear the train here?
No.
No, not train. Wait,
y'all don't hear it?
I can't even hear it from your end.
Yeah, we did.
Here, here.
No.
Hold up.
Don't get too close to the thing.
No, I can't hear it.
Stop now.
But see, these iPhone microphones, they can't pick up.
iPhone microphones, bro.
So, no, yeah, it literally stopped.
if it's the same train, though, I think that you... I wonder how far away you moved if that is the same train.
What do that train be carrying, though? And where do it be going?
Like a whole bunch of stuff. For the most part, it's just like goods.
My mom said it's the train that's in Tucker, too. But I don't think it's the same one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Back to... Okay, do you guys agree that is a pro of the guy as a director? Maybe it's not just like a pro of the movie's directing. But just the guy Martin Scorsese as a director. Is that a pro?
Oh my goodness. Oh yeah, I'm getting another car.
Huh? Maybe what?
Okay, hold on. Let me just hold on one second. Hello?
I think he got another call.
Oh, all I right. thought he was getting kicked out of the call.
Okay, no problem. But Nebby, as soon as you're done, you can come back. Billy, would you say that's a pro? The ability for him to accept other people's concepts and ideas so easily.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. That's a pro.
Because I've heard other people argue, and I think this is more of the sadistic side. It's just like that can become a con, but it is 100% a pro.
Are you guys trying to play Among Us later?
probably not. I think this might go a bit late.
Yeah.
So maybe like next time.
Yeah.
Where did this come from?
I just got like a card from like Undiscord. I'll give you like a quote if you want. It's, they're not playing yet, but they'll play later.
Who?
Like, did you say on Discord?
Yeah, like Miles and just somebody like Nigel, you know? And
okay. I mean, we're probably not going to be done for a little bit. I told you, this one's going to be kind of long. I think we're going a bit quicker with the other categories, though.
Right.
So, Nebby, your opinion? Pro or con, Scorsese's like willingness to just accept other people's ideas and actually incorporate them into his content?
That's undoubtedly a pro.
Okay.
Man, open mind.
Yeah, I'm trying to see how it could be a con. I mean,
I think I've heard the argument that not that it's a con like automatically. It's like after some time, if they're too willing, then it can be. It's like eventually you could become a simp in a sense. Not like literally, but like in a sense, you know, a simp is so it's kind of like catering to the demands of a woman.
Yeah.
Ooh, you have like the definition of a simp.
Listen, bro, I catch on quickly. Leave me alone.
I don't even know the definition memorized. Like with a man is not specifically engaged in that bit.
All right. But yeah, I mean that's how it could become a con. Now, talking about the cinematography in and of itself, and just like the directing overall and the editing overall. Well, maybe not editing here. I think I would be doing this movie a disservice if I did not bring up the Copacabana shot. And if you do not know what the Copacabana shot is off the title, you almost will certainly know it off of the shot in the video itself, the scene. I'm going to actually play the whole thing. It's about a minute and a half long.
Her name was Lola. She was. Hey,
you guys can hear this and see it?
No, it's good. Hey. Every time I come here, every time you do.
You guys saw that?
Yeah.
You guys remember that?
I always wonder why in every Italian movies there's a scene where like the boss or whatever, somebody important is walking through a kitchen to go to Saddle restaurant.
What other Italian movies is this in? I can't think of it off the top of my head. All right, but back to the shot. All right. So first of all, starting off with cinematography. How much do I need to talk about that? I feel like it might be clear. How much should I talk about that? Or do you guys want to talk about the cinematography here?
Wait.
Cinematography, just the camera movement. It's all one shot, first of all. This itself, just watching it, I'll get into like what it really meant when I get to the directing. But this is a pretty big feat of cinematography. Like, think about this. This is a set. And it is pretty hard to continuously get one camera shot going. This, I think, this takes, I'm assuming, multiple days. There's a video out there about the making of this. Can't remember all the facts right now. There are hundreds of people who worked on this series of shot, on this just singular shot, but this series of events. Mm-hmm. And it is quite a feat. You can see here, kind of like the, when it comes to cinematography and you think of colors, you can see him coming in from this red, like this red hue, moving into a bit of a brighter hue going in. And then the working class, kind of him interacting with them, coming back into the red hue, kind of being immersed into the world. And on that note, of like the immersion into the world, a direct quote from Mr. Martin Scorsese is that the Copacabana shot had to be done in one sweeping shot because it is his seduction of her, her being Karen Hill, and it's also the lifestyle seducing him.
Hey.
Now, the first part, seduction of her, that I think that part is obvious, right?
Yeah, okay.
Now think about the second part. This is something I never contemplated, but once I saw this quote, it kind of became obvious. This is his lifestyle, and he clearly loves this lifestyle. And in many ways, it's the lifestyle. Maybe I understand him saying seducing him, as in like he craves the power, and the fact that he has so much sway around here seduces him into continuing doing that, right? But also, I think maybe not seducing, it definitely immerses us into his world. The fact that in this minute and a half, because up until this point, remember, this is here the ninth scene. Eight scenes prior, that's us learning about why he loves this life so much. It's us being introduced to the lifestyle. This scene right here, and there's plenty of shots there. Shoot, the first shot, we're talking about cinematography, it's completely bathed in red, violence. The symbolizing behind the color red is innumerable, and there's a lot that I could talk about there. But I really want to highlight this one because obviously it's one of the most famous ones, and there's a lot to highlight here. Look at, like I was saying, sorry for getting a bit off track. Up until this point, all we've seen is kind of a very, like I've said with the script, subtle introduction into the world, introduction into his mind. This is the first time where we get to really see his sway in the world, his power. In the fact that, first of all, it's all one complete shot. It is just a fluid motion. His life seems to be kind of this, like a merry-go-round of just everything is working for him. It seems everybody, as he's walking, everybody gets out the way for him. He is interacting with people. He has this community that quite literally loves him, and he seemingly loves them back. And I think that's kind of what it means by seducing him. Do you guys have any separate interpretation? That's kind of how I interpreted it. Do you guys have any separate interpretations from that? Because I saw Billy kind of... I know, like, when I first saw it, I was, like, seducing him. That was... That part right there, it was interesting. And that I feel like that's... if you remember the dialogue paper that we had to write for film last year, one of the main things I'm pretty sure a lot of people talk about was the subtext. And that's kind of like the subtext that I 100% did not notice on my original watch. And I didn't even notice until seeing this comment here. Do you guys?
Bruh.
Chillax, man. My mom's right there.
Oh, shoot. I didn't even know.
Children.
Not erase it. I erase it. Did I erase it?
All right, but Do you guys have any other interpretations?
Could you repeat again? Like, I heard seduction for her. What exactly did he say again? Sorry.
Okay. It, can you not see the screen? You can see it, right?
Yeah.
Oh, had to be done in one super shot because it's his seduction of her and it's also...
a lifestyle seducing him.
Okay. Yeah. Then I agree with what you said. Because literally as soon as he walked in, they called his name. Like, they called him by his name, knowing that he's like a... he's like a regular or like he's a boss. And they literally went in the front and made a whole table for him.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it, that probably made him feel special. And like it made him look good too to his girl.
Yeah, yeah. That's that whole idea of a seduction of her.
Yeah.
Okay. Now before I get into the I'll begin with the use of titles is kind of not this one isn't super subtle. This is something I picked up on, and this might be more of a script thing, but I added it here because it goes with the editing and possibly a bit of the directing. And this is specifically the opening scene. If you guys remember, well, first of all, these titles, like the sweeping back and forth, that kind of is like the first concept that we get. Like the first, Scorsese himself in an interview said, the title sequence is one of the most, is possibly the most important part of a movie, because in a lot of cases, if you're not going to use it properly, just don't use it at all, right? Yeah. So the title slides, and I kind of talked about just like the importance of titles in and of himself. The one thing that stood out to me that I kind of wanted to point out about the editing with the title slides is, well, first of all, when you guys see that this film is based on a true story, how much of an impact does that have? I feel like a lot of people kind of just gloss over that, at least while they're watching it.
Well, yeah, while I'm watching it,
yeah,
I don't think about it.
Yeah. But, this one is a very simple one, and it's nothing crazy. Here is the title. I think they give us a date in a few seconds. New York, 1970. And then later on when we don't return to the scene in and of itself, but later on we get the same title. It's like June 11th, 1970. And that's kind of a nice little visual storytelling gem. And on that scene itself, what I feel is a good directing choice, and I would like to get your opinions on this. You guys know the Billy Bat scene, correct?
Yeah.
Billy Bats gets whacked. And then the scene that technically prefaces this, the opening scene.
Oh, yeah.
Originally, the script had that entire scene as the opening.
No, not.
And the decision was to just have this part.
Yeah, it's definitely better.
Definitely a better decision. Billy?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
But how the freak do you know so much about this, Yabo?
Damn, he be doing his research.
He doing that research.
Okay, we got a bit into the Copacabana. Now, this is... Well, I have an example of this editing, and like I call the editing in this film flawless, and I am enraged. I am filled with furious anger, and my rage has been unleashed when I hear that this movie did not win best editing, because it's pretty flawless throughout it.
I want to see what this other movie is about, but what?
This thing dances with wolves has got to be something great.
Yeah,
but have you did you
hear about it? Like,
oh yeah, I've heard about it in like interviews with Kevin Costner, and it's like brought up. I've heard about like how it was made, but nothing beyond that, because even when I, just like outside of that sphere, a lot of people are kind of pissed off that Goodfellas didn't win all of those things this year. It's kind of a travesty, quite frankly. And if you like ever look at a list of biggest Oscar snubs. Goodfellas not winning Best Picture is one of them. Best Directing is one of them. A lot of things for Scorsese not winning Best Directing because he didn't win until The Departed in 2009 or 2007. And that was after he's been working for at least maybe even 40 years. So that in and of itself is kind of crazy. Now, an example of like this, not necessarily flawless, but very fluid editing technique is here. I'll share the sound. I don't think it is 100% necessary.
I gotta admit the truth. It turned me on.
When she was asked to put away the gun.
That was a weird scene, to be honest.
That which one?
The one where she had a Glock to this man's face, but like, what was she trying to do to this man?
No, okay, no, that's not this scene, first of all. And we can talk about that scene in a second. Let me get through this real quick. I have some comments on what you said. A few comments. But this is an example of the editing and kind of like, I know, Billy, you know about match cuts.
I gotta admit the truth. It turned me on.
This is an example of that, and it kind of, it's an example of how well the editing is done here. And it's something nice. And then also a perfect example of the juxtaposition of the cinematography. Did you guys notice that there are two different weddings?
Yeah, I noticed that.
My first viewing, I did not. This time around, I did notice it. What else? Nebby, do you want to point out anything else about the, quite frankly, the difference between this wedding and this wedding?
The first wedding was gigantic. The one that's on screen right now. And the one with his family was small. And I feel like he was definitely more of himself, you know, in the second wedding. And the first
one. Oh, first of all, I would like to say this is not his family. This is her family. That's why he has the yarmulke on and everything, because he's pretending to be Jewish.
Yeah.
Oh.
You don't remember his mom? Her mom saying he's not even Jewish.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, but I thought he was still like Italian or like, I don't know.
The yarmulke doesn't mean you're Italian. That means you're Jewish.
Yeah, Italians are not even like Jewish. They're like Catholic.
Catholics. Yeah.
Oh. Oh, but who's she then? She's not Italian.
She might be Italian, but I know she's Jewish for sure. It's a possibility she's Italian. I'm not sure of that.
Yeah. I remember the scene with his cross, but I didn't even realize that.
Yeah. Okay. It's kind of, you know how for Henry, in the very beginning, he's talking about ever since you know the line. And remember the opening shot that I talked about when he was looking out of the window and it was his family kind of crammed into this one really tiny apartment, and outside it was this luscious lifestyle of the gangsters, all of them having fun. Remember that, right?
Yeah, right.
I think this is like the parallelism in the structure where we go from that over to here, but now it's flipped around, because you guys do remember that for a good amount of the time, like once he meets Karen, she begins to narrate. She begins to become a character of her own. And that was weird to you.
Yeah, because the whole time it was like the main character. Then she was given like this really big.
I kind of like that decision, because in a good amount of Hollywood movies, female character is fairly kind of like brushed aside. And here she's given her a pretty good arc of her own. And she isn't relegated to just like this character over here.
Yeah.
It could possibly be, you know, Scorsese himself is a very devout, maybe not devout. He was a Catholic. He was an Italian American. And that could be like the idea of, you know, once you get married, it's a conjoining of a soul, or of two souls into one.
Was it after they got married?
I don't mean literally. I just mean like spiritually, you know, how when you get married, it's supposed to be two people becoming one. So that's that could be an homage to like he gets married and then, or he meets who he's about to marry and who he goes on to marry. And it's kind of one. They become one. Both of them are narrating now. She's giving her perspective. He's giving his perspective. And we kind of get this juxtaposing life. But in many ways, I genuinely think that these two were made for each other because they have a lot of the same desires. Here, you see her family. And if you're able to see kind of the mannerisms in the background, this guy right here, he doesn't look too happy. Guy right here, he looks a bit mad, right? It doesn't seem like she's beloved, or that maybe she is beloved, but it doesn't seem like her lifestyle as a Jew, as a part of her old family, is that great, right? Mm-hmm. But here, she's astonished. She's like, oh, this is the lifestyle for me. She is happy. She's being introduced to all of these other people. This is Timmy. This is Timmy. This is Janine and Janice and Janice. You know, despite all that, she's a...
Everybody was either Timmy or what?
I don't remember specifically, but everybody just had the same name. And it's kind of like, once again, like the opposing of the two different lifestyles. And quite frankly, I think all of us can understand why she wants to stay in this lifestyle. And in a lot of ways, the filmmaking kind of makes it a constraint for her. When you think about the narrative and how she rarely ever leaves the apartment, that's kind of like an allusion to the fact that, think about it, if she were to leave Henry, which she doesn't want to do, and I think she knows that she really can't, she leaves him, she knows a bit too much information. She's probably going to get whacked. That's something that came to mind as I was watching it, and I was like, oh, that's tough.
You know, they actually got divorced in real life?
Yeah, but afterwards, yeah. Now, go ahead.
One thing I like with with her was in the salon, when she just like realized what she got into, like with all these, like what they were talking about.
Oh, yeah. When she was like, oh, all of them were so ugly. She was like, oh, I'm too beautiful for these people.
Oh, yeah. And how they were talking like murder and stuff.
And she kind of, she got a bit scared. She was like, what if you go to jail, Henry? That stupid Jimmy, he went to jail. Probably wasn't Jimmy, but some dude. And then man straight seduced her. He was like, you know what, honey? That's actually one thing that I caught on to this time again. That dialogue, he was like, nobody wants to go unless they want to go to jail.
Oh, yeah.
Do you guys think that, I mean, this is Scorsese. This is a pretty well-made movie. A simple line like that just doesn't get thrown in out of nowhere. Huh? Do you think that has any implications in what happens later on?
Well, they did go to jail for that one time, but then they got released. Yeah. It was sort of a pretty weird thing. Like, I never really...
Oh, shoot. I think I just figured it out. You know how it's like nobody goes to jail unless they want to go to jail? Like, they're not organized, right? Think about it. The reason why he went to jail is because he was down in Florida, you know, the first time at least, beating on that guy, right? And then that guy's sister turned out to be an FBI typist, right?
Oh, that was...
So, but remember why he went on that? Because... Why? Karen was all pissed off, right, about him always being with his girlfriend, and they decided, or the Paul Edis was like, all right, you know what, you got to go back, blah blah blah, and he was like, okay, so because of your choices of doing all of this, and because you weren't organized, like he said, you got to be organized all the time, you got to go down. So if he hadn't messed up in that aspect, and he wasn't disorganized in that aspect of his life, he wouldn't have had to go down, and he wouldn't have gone to prison. And then,
as conviction, man. He was just not organized. But with regards to like wanting to go to jail,
and it kind of comments on the lifestyle that he chose to, like him two timing. Was he? Do you guys think that he had another? Do you think that's like how deep it went? I feel like there were even more women though.
For sure.
In his life.
Yeah.
I think if it's for the plot sake that they only show like a couple.
I also heard this kind of changes it a good amount. And it's probably a good thing that it wasn't added to the plot. I also heard that Karen herself had been cheating on him.
Probably, yeah.
With actually Tommy. And that is one of the reasons why Tommy did eventually get whacked. That was like one of the reasons, in addition to Billy Bats. And then apparently he had, in real life, he had actually killed some other made men too. So that was...
You know, the book is like, it follows exactly like the true story.
Oh, the book is like, I believe, really true. Because I'm sure there were also some liberties there, because it wasn't like directly written by Henry Hill. And once again, Henry Hill, maybe kind of narrating his life, does probably omit maybe a few things, but sure. Expectedly it is well done. And well, this final point is something that I have definitely talked about with the back when I was talking about the script, and how in these planning of the storytelling devices and from one scene to the next, I don't think anything in this movie just serves one purpose. Everything has dual, triple, a whole bunch of purposes throughout. And
if that's true, then I got a question about one scene. Remember when they were in the jail and she was mad at him and she was throwing all like the drugs that she was smuggling in? Mm-hmm. Remember the police officer, he noticed, he saw it?
Mm-hmm.
What did this man do about it, bro? This
Nothing. Man just... Think about it. That is calling, first of all, the police officer or the guard that saw it, that calls back to the fact that in the scene before, he was the one allowing for Henry to sell the drugs. He knows about this. He doesn't really care. He's trying to turn his cheek. And that also, this whole idea of a dual service, that calls back to how the local police are in the town. You get your share, we don't care. That rhymed. So it's true. I was trying to think of a word that rhymed.
That's how it works.
Yeah. See, a lot of the things in there's probably, I mean, there's everything I feel you can probably come up with the dual purpose, or even more than that purpose that it serves. And that's kind of a necessity with screenwriting. But once again, I heard there's this quote that was like, every single great film has to have the basics at least, right? There, no film can be great unless it at least fulfills the basics. And this fulfills the basics and goes leagues ahead. And that's why it is great.
That's true.
Aesthetics-wise. Now, aesthetics is just visual beauty overall. I've talked about the cinematography. I've talked about the directing, the editing, some of the set design, some of the colors used. But kind of leaning away from like the super analytical film buff side, when you guys were watching it, or Billy, when you, from what you remember watching, how appealing was the movie to the eyes, like of all the movies that you've seen, is it something that you would necessarily label as beautiful, or just a film that okay, starting off with base level one, does it accomplish visually what it wants to do? Would you guys say that?
Let me give you the full answer.
Go ahead, Billy, go ahead.
Appealing to the eye, I'm gonna say yeah, because of how it perfectly implements the timeline for me, at least. If I had imagined the 70s or late 70s in this case, of when Italian mobs were prominent, I'd imagine this looked like this. The cars, the style of this guy that you were just on, that always has a cigar in his hand, the way he dressed, the way they just post outside of a store late at night, it just embodies the timeline for me. And that, I think that's what I love about it. And he made me, like, I don't know, he made me perfectly visualize what Italian mobster times were.
Absolutely.
So that's what makes it very visually appealing for me.
Okay.
And I already talked about this.
Good.
I was going to talk about, like, their suits. All of them, how they all wear suits when they don't really need to. Like, they're chilling at a bar at night. They all got suits on. Yeah. Right.
Nebby, before you go, I want to make this point real quick. I feel that. Do you guys know who Edgar Wright is?
Yeah, Edgar Allan Wright.
The guy who made the. You remember the Cornetto trilogy, Shaun of the Dead?
Yeah. I remember Hamza doing Edgar. That guy.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to the types of videos that I make, just video essays, I believe there are two directors that would absolutely excel with the video essay. The first is Edgar Wright. And I'm not sure how much of Edgar Wright you guys have seen. I'm pretty sure, Billy, you've seen Shaun of the Dead. I don't want to talk too much about that. I would like to talk about that whenever we do his movie for the podcast. But when it comes to Scorsese, I think it... especially with the fact that he uses narration so much, the visual storytelling aspect is almost perfect. And I don't mean perfect can have many meanings, but like here, I legitimately mean he does it. Timing is perfect, and what is happening is perfect. An example, and right here. Nobody's. I'm just gonna.
Before he could do anything, especially run up bills on the joint.
You guys can hear it, right?
No.
You can't hear it.
Is it paying?
Yeah. Can you hear it?
Oh, yeah.
Is it good?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. You want...
Kidding, huh? Fuck you, pay me. Also, Paulie could do anything, especially run up bills on the joint's credit. And why not? Nobody's gonna pay for it anyway. And as soon as the deliveries are made in the front door, you move the stuff out the back and sell it at a discount. You take a $200 case of booze and you sell it.
I'm going to be a teacher here for a second. Would anybody like to point out what they just saw there? I will replay it. What he said, I'll say it. I'll repeat. I hope it becomes obvious when I repeat it. Something comes in through the front door. Well, fuck it. Comes right back out through the back. What are you saying?
Oh. He's talking about the box.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, he's talking about the boxes. He's talking about how the business works, how they pretty much finesse, how Paulie finesses his way into becoming a millionaire. He burns down these places. He wrecks these businesses for his own benefit. Specifically, this is something that it's probably because I do make video essays and I kind of pay attention to these things as I'm making them. These are things that are not hard to do. But it has to be meticulously crafted in order to do it. And this is something that a lot of comedies necessitate. You see something, or if a comedy is just saying something, it's pretty much stand up. It doesn't need to be a movie. But what makes a comedy movie is you get to see the visuals and the oral aesthetics playing together. And that is what happens here frequently. That is narration is often seen as like a cop-out. Here, it is used as an enhancer.
Yeah. This is the best, like, probably narrating movie I think I've ever seen.
All right. Okay. So, those are all of the points that I have for aesthetics. Nebby, visual appeal. I want to start off because I know you've been with me for every movie review that I've done on the channel, on the podcast, right?
Yeah.
The Room, The Disaster Artist, The Gentleman, Rashomon. This is our fifth. I think I'll go ahead and eliminate The Room from this.
Yeah.
Of the other three, The Gentleman, The Disaster Artist, and Rashomon. Do any of them come to, like, the visual aesthetic appeal of this? Do they, any of them surpass it or even come close?
Visual aesthetic, maybe The Gentleman is better, to be honest. The
thing is, with that one, I can understand. I'm gonna stop saying that. I feel like it might get annoying. I do understand it, though. I do understand where you're coming from. In that, but think about how much The Gentleman has been influenced by Goodfellas. Just like kind of let that ruminate in your mind. That's another one where you really, really think about it. when I'm thinking about The Gentleman, I'm now actually, now that you brought it up, don't you think that there, it takes a good amount of inspiration from here?
For sure, yeah. I mean, but you know.
But I would disagree that it surpasses it. I know The Gentleman has narration. I don't think the narration in The Gentleman comes close to this.
That this movie was made 30 years ago, and it's like,
that's the thing. I really feel that this is one of those where if it came out today, same reception, man.
Same reception.
I mean, for goodness sake, you're watching it today and you're receiving it the same way.
That's true.
Like, that is, it's kind of crazy to think about. You're watching. Okay, Billy's back, so let's see. Billy,
I'm not back yet. I just want to like listen while I'm
food. Okay, no problem. But once again, you watched it today, I'm assuming, or yesterday?
Yesterday.
You watched it yesterday. For people who don't know when we're recording this, November the 24th, 2020. Over 30 years, a month, and about 6 days after the release of Goodfellas. And you are receiving it just as well as people did back then. And maybe even better because of it's had time to, it has aged, like you said, like fine wine, right?
I know. Right.
You good?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. You said it's aged like fine wine. Yeah. You watched it 30 years and sometime afterwards, and you still think it's amazing. And visually, I actually think that visually, Goodfellas is a bit underrated.
Yeah.
Because people...
because I can't point to one thing and say, like, as I can in, let's say, Lord of the Rings or something.
No, but the thing is, I just did. And I did that multiple times.
I mean, yeah, but that one wasn't like...
Which one? The Copacabana shot? Remember the one, that one long shot that I just showed you? That I mean, up there...
I wouldn't say it's...
You wouldn't say it's what?
Great TV. In my personal, my humble opinion.
Okay. Okay, so are you saying they're... right here, this Goodfellas' Copacabana is legitimately on their top scenes ever. Just ever. Really? Yes.
Like, that memorable. I'm telling you, Lord of the Rings is going to be above that in this list. If they're wise.
I mean, it depends. I mean, Lord of the Rings, that's a difficult conversation.
What? Well, literally the ending when they were on that mountain was one of the best shots I think I've ever seen in my life. And I felt like it was such a unique, it was so amazing. And like that's something like I walk away with, or like in the end of what was the movie I was thinking about? I mean, yeah, just basically like nothing really of camera work really gets me in this movie.
I want
to
say,
just to be honest, that, you know, thinking about what they had access to.
Listen, Nebby, I'm gonna forgive you. I'm not gonna whack you right now, because this is your first watch. I promise you, after a few watches, I'm surprised that the Copacabana shot didn't like kind of maybe not wow you, but it is something that the first time I saw it, I was like, okay, that's great. And it's being used greatly, and after thinking back to it, I was like, the way that they made it just has to be. And after we're done with the podcast, I want you to watch this video by Cinefix, which is about the making of the Copacabana. And I think it might help you to understand kind of like why it is just so great. This one right here, I will send it to you, and I would very much like you to watch it. And I would like to revisit that concept of no single thing when we get to best scene. But I do really think that it is underrated. Well, there's one maybe in... I can't find it right now, but if you can't remember, when they have to go back and dig up Billy Batts's body. You remember that scene?
Mm-hmm.
They're like absolutely bathed in just red, and the way that they're set up is an extreme long shot. They're really minimal.
Ooh,
and
if
you remember that, I think that might possibly, I actually, what you said about Lord of the Rings, that shot, it is hard to argue with it. I love Lord of the Rings. Lord of the Rings is great. But that is up. Yeah. That's up there. That's like a single shot that is stuck in my mind, and I'm not sure if it might ever leave. And while this is like not on that level, the shot of Karen with the gun on his face, that's something that is stuck in my mind. That's not going to leave my mind. Those are shots that are in my mind because they were so meticulously crafted. They might not, the latter might not necessarily be just like this great visual beauty. I think the former arguably is the one where they're bathed in red and they're super small in the screen. And the scene itself is like a great telling of the character of Henry Hill. He's out there. He clearly doesn't belong in that scene. If you can remember, he's like throwing up. He doesn't belong in this life, right?
Yeah, I agree. But, you know, that's what I want to talk about, the score, though. Remember the score during that
part? We're going to get there.
Getting excited.
We're going to get there. That's actually next up.
All right, let's do it. Let's do it.
Man, it's going to be hard for me to talk about the score.
Yeah.
Actually, as we're talking about the score, I think I might play some of it in the background to kind of refresh our minds. But for right now, let's give our scores for the aesthetics. And Billy, are you going to be able to give your score right now? Because you are the one that's supposed to go first. We can have you go last if it's more convenient.
Give me a second. I'll be right back to the camera soon.
Okay.
I can't go first though.
No problem. Nevi, you haven't gone first, so I want you to go first for the aesthetics.
All right, aesthetics, I'm gonna say 8.
I am not gonna lie. I was actually kind of like thinking that I was worried that you were gonna give us something lower.
I was thinking about a 7 or a 7.5, but you know. Convince me, I guess.
I was like really. I'm not gonna lie. I was trying pretty hard to convince you. Okay, now for me, as I said, I really think that the aesthetics here are underrated.
Mm-hmm.
And by aesthetics, but being underrated, I mean I don't think the cinematography or the directing is underrated. I think that is perfectly rated. It is widely regarded as some of the greatest ever. I'm gonna give it a pretty high score just because of those two. But I'm gonna give it an even higher score due to the fact that. Visually, I think that people don't respect this as much as they should. And there are plenty.
How did you know that that scene was going to be in that website?
I actually didn't. I kind of just like hoped. No, I genuinely, I legitimately did not know. It was at number 32. Do you think that I would have, like, if I knew it was at 32, then I would have just been like, bet I would. I wouldn't do that. I just searched it up.
But that was the first try, and that was
okay. Fun. You know what? Actually, it was my first try because it was the first website. Yeah, it was the first website, right there. First website. I mean, we can look at some more. Maybe not most influential. Famous isn't necessarily the same thing as best. We'll see if it's still up here. I don't think it's here. It's not on this list. But that's famous. Famous isn't the same thing. Okay, best. We'll see again. We'll see again. Where are we at? Goodfellas? I don't think it's here. It's not here. It was in the first list. I promise you, looking back, if you would like, I could replay it. And you know how it's blue if you've been there before and it's purple if it's blue if you haven't been there before. I'll show you that it was blue. But back to aesthetics, I was talking about just like how the visual beauty of it is underrated. And I legitimately think that aesthetically, this movie is near perfect. And as much as I want to give it a 10, I just know there's better out there. Movies such as Barry Lyndon, and once again, The Godfather and The Godfather Part Two, the counterparts to this in many ways, just have better cinematography overall, but or arguably better. I myself would have to like really think about that before confidently saying that. But for now, I'm going to give it a 9.75. Billy, if you are able to.
I was just talking and then I realized my mic was muted, but that is too high.
The thing is, did you like hear me speaking?
Yeah, I heard you talking. I was talking about. Oh, you're talking
about. No. I mean, like, just like me speaking over this entire time.
Oh,
what else did you expect? I've been praising this. Like, I genuinely do think that this is super high. The thing is, I didn't want to give it a 10 because, like I said, I know of other. I've seen other movies that have better, but there's no movie out there that I can say has exponentially, or like not even exponentially, has something that will give it a from a 1 to a 10 a gap of more than a 0.5. And in this case, I really don't think a gap of more than a 0.25. In my opinion, I'll probably have Goodfellas in like the top 100 greatest aesthetically pleasing films I've ever seen. And I mean, as I see more, it might move out, but as of right now, still in. And I think when it comes to a lot of these things, rewatching it over and over again, it really helps to make that stuff stand out. Nebby, talking about just like the idea of being able to rewatch, how long do you think it'll be before you do? Is this like something where you finish it and then you're like, oh, shoot, I really want to watch that again? Or do you think you're going to take a good amount of time in between this viewing and the next?
Take a good minute, but there's a lot of movies I gotta get to. But I want to watch this movie with the boys or with a group of people next time because I feel like it's more enjoyable. I feel like this is almost like a good movie, you know what I mean?
You know, I want to like one day reenact one of these scenes with you guys, probably like the funny house scene, just like for my channel, my main channel, just like reenact that scene if we're ever like able to like gather up enough money. To like kind of set up the stages and then get the, I mean, we can probably finesse with the clothes and stuff, but you know,
that's gonna be a great thing for your channel.
I would love to do that. Yeah,
like reenact movies.
Yeah, one day I would love to do that if we ever have the ability. But now that Billy's here, I've given it a 9.75. I think you might have heard my reasoning for it. Nebby gave it an 8. I'm pretty sure if you heard my reason, you probably heard his. It's up to you. I hope that's not too much pressure.
I'm giving it a 9.5. I don't know. There's nothing you can say by aesthetic that's gonna make me like think it was bad.
Yeah, Nebby, suck it, man. Suck it, Nebby.
From the intro scene to the scene of him picking up a newspaper in his witness protection house. Everything was well edited. Great cuts. Great zoom ins. It was just perfect. Not perfect, but you know.
No, the thing is, I think that it is very, maybe I won't say it is perfect right now. It is near perfect. The reason I didn't give it a perfect score is because I know there are probably some things that are better than it. Like I would almost definitely say that The Godfathers is better. And I know it's getting old of me just like saying that a whole bunch of times, but it's Goodfellas. It's expected to be compared. Nebby. Well, we're not going to talk about it right now. Once we come back one more time, we're going to get into the score. I'm going to search it up so I can have it playing in the background. But Bill, do you remember the score?
Mm-mm.
I'm telling you, as soon as you start hearing it, you're going to remember it. Maybe. I mean, I can't say for sure, but. You can hear that, right?
That sounds like the wedding or something.
No, that's the first scene. Not the first scene, but that's the opening credits. That's like once he's like, ever since I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster, closes it. This is what's playing throughout the opening credits. My clothes may still be
torn and tattered. Well, it is giving me an idea of what the whole film is like.
Yeah, I have. Well, I'm gonna stop saying I have a good amount to say about it. I told you guys, this one's good. I have a lot to say about this movie.
In terms of score?
Oh, definitely in terms of score, especially since I watched another Scorsese movie this week, and I have some comments in that with that compared to this. We have now gotten the scores down for acting, script, and the plot, script/plot, and the aesthetics. We are now moving on to the score. And Nebby was very eager to talk about the score. Take it away.
What I'm going to say is this score was, it was alright. It was just like a regular score in a regular old movie. And that's basically all I got to say. It wasn't the focus of the movie. I know Yabenek's face looking like I'm just capping, but that's just the facts. That's just the facts. And the movie, the music was good, but that's what you expect from a movie. So, can't really, you know, say too much on that. But this, I wouldn't say the music really did anything, you know, extraordinary. Like the trailer of Tenet with that music that got you hyped.
So, on Sunday, I watched my 10th Scorsese film, Mean Streets.
What's it called?
Mean Streets. It's on Netflix, I'm pretty sure, right now. It was, I think, his second feature length, second film. 1973. It has De Niro in it. No Pesci, though. It's similarly about mafia. It's about low-level hoodlums, you know, they live in their life. And in this is one of his earlier works, so I know it's anytime anybody in their earlier years, it's a bit more of experimental filmmaking, but I absolutely despise the choices in music here, mainly because they all seem so out of place. And I know there are plenty of people who would say otherwise, and it's kind of clear. I know, Billy, you've seen a few Scorsese flicks, and it is, he has a very specific style. He likes to use non-diegetic sound, specifically just like songs. He loves the Rolling Stones. He loves music that he loved as a teenager. He loves to put in music from the 70s. And clearly that continues here. But opposed to the score of Mean Streets, which, like I said, it just felt out of place to me. And the music, I think, actually made me kind of dislike the movie a little bit. In spite of it being a pretty good story, nothing mind-blowing, very well shot, the music just felt so out of place all the time to me.
In this movie?
No, in Mean Streets.
Oh, all right, I was about to say.
Now, moving on to Goodfellas, something that he made 17 years later and definitely with a lot more experience. I rewatched Goodfellas after I watched Mean Streets. And I went in fearing that I would have the same reaction because it is the same director. And I was paying a lot of attention to the music here. Well, I was paying a lot of attention to everything I've seen by the fact that I've been talking for like 5 hours about this stuff. But the music in particular, I think it goes hand in hand with the aesthetics, with a lot of what I've talked about with aesthetics. It's very fluidic. And as opposed to like the out of place feeling, in Mean Streets, it is very, very different. It is very fitting here. But Nebby, you're gonna be very surprised here. I slightly agree with you. In that I've never been a fan. I've never been like the biggest fan of Scorsese scores. He has a very specific style. They're just like, it's either you're a fan of them or you're not. And the thing is, I'm a fan of them. Yeah. In The Wolf of Wall Street, half the time I'm a fan, half of the time I'm not. In Mean Streets, I am just not. In Goodfellas, I think it's kind of split like 80-20. I am 80% of the time, and 20% of the not, I'm not. I can't remember specifically what the 20% was. But I feel there were moments where it felt like it, Mean Streets, where it almost lingered on the side of not fitting. Because the guy has a very clear taste, and his taste doesn't match with everything that he directs. But I think it matches for the most part with what he's directing here. And remember, this one is going to be out of 5. And as I'm listening back to it...
Okay.
As I'm listening back to the score here, I don't remember this. Do you guys remember this?
Yeah, I'm saying. Well, I do not remember.
There are 4 or 5 in particular that are really stand out to me, and I'll talk about them after I let Billy talk. Oh, I thought you were about to talk. Yeah, I thought you were about to open it, everything, man.
I don't know. I was gonna ask you if you could play like 2 scores, like look, 2 30-second snips of 2 different scores of scenes that I would remember, like anybody would remember.
I'm kind of surprised you did not remember, because I think the first one, the first song chosen, "Rags to Riches," is, well, first of all, it's almost perfect as is. And that's one of the things that before I do let it play out, that's something that I do worry at times, that Scorsese's music choices don't like 100% match the rhythm, because he kind of just chooses what he likes at times, and it definitely is obvious. And like I said, at times I like it, at times I don't. This is almost like a perfect song for the movie, "Rags to Riches." That's, I don't need to explain that. I'll just go ahead and play it.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
I know I'd go from rags to riches. I'm kind of surprised you didn't remember that. That one is kind of just stuck in my head.
Well, I don't know. I don't remember sounds. I remember like pictures and images, but
I understand that. I understand that. And I think these are actually the 2 things that are going to keep this score not afloat, but like keep the score in still that like legendary territory, as it has done with me for all of the other parts where I don't think I've gone before below a 9.9, is the first opening one. And I don't think this is necessarily one that you would like remember. But once again, this one is almost. I should probably turn the noise up a little bit. This one is near perfect in just like the meaning of it. I think you might remember this song, Billy.
I have to wait around like everyone else.
Not like remember.
Can't even get decent food. Right after I got here, I ordered some spaghetti with marinara sauce, and I got egg noodles and ketchup. I'm an average nobody. Get to live the rest of my life like a schnook.
Thank you. Billy, do you recognize that? Do you recognize that? Is it just a song?
No, I don't recognize it from this scene. But
I recognize it
definitely doesn't go with the scene.
Think Frank Sinatra.
Frank Sinatra?
My Way. That is a rock rendition of the song My Way. I'm pretty sure you know that song, right?
Yeah, I do know that song.
That is, for its meaning, that's almost perfect. It is talking about doing it his way. He tried his best throughout his entire life to do it, quote-unquote, my way.
Oh, yeah.
And, well, that itself, the history behind why it is the rock rendition, is that Frank Sinatra wasn't willing to give them the rights to it because Frank Sinatra himself has a good amount of ties with the mafia and how his comeuppance was. Billy, do you remember, I can't remember his name right now, the guy from The Godfather in the opening scene, the famous dude, the singer, remember him?
The dude in Las Vegas?
Yeah. Well, see, in Las Vegas, the guy that, like, had a... Hold up. It was in The Godfather, the opening scenes, one of the persons, like, he was dressed in all white, and he was singing.
Yeah, I remember. I don't remember his name, but I do remember the guy in all white.
I don't remember his name. Do you remember what he did? Because he was a singer. And he was looking, he went directly to the Godfather because he was looking for an acting job, right?
Acting position, and the dude would give it to him.
That is a direct allusion to Frank Sinatra. That is pretty much what Frank Sinatra did. He had very close ties with the mafia. That was like, they couldn't use the name directly, but that's Frank Sinatra pretty much. So he was not willing to give them the rights to the song My Way. So they decided on this. Quick question.
They gave the mafia.
I know Billy knows.
Frank Sinatra did not want to give it to them?
Did not. He did not want to give them the rights because he himself was already pretty closely tied with the mafia and he didn't want any more connections being made there.
They're all good. Gotcha.
So, okay. First of all, which rendition would have made sense here? The normal one or the one that was used? Because I actually think that the one that was used was... I actually think it was tonally better. The normal one is because remember, this is like right after the guy goes through addiction and he has this downfall. And I think that tonally fits. I feel like the first one, and compared to in conjunction with the rest of the songs used here, I think it fits tonally. I kind of want to get your perspective on it because I can see it going either way. Nebby, do you know the original rendition of My Way? Nebby.
All right,
lagging out. Yeah, bro.
Oh, that's me.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, well, maybe it's me, man.
Billy. Who was lagging on your again? Side, me or Nebby?
Nebby.
Okay, so I was just asking, do you know? I'm gonna go ahead and play it. Tell me which one makes more sense to you, Nebby, this version or the other version. And Billy.
And now.
Nebby, did you say I have to go?
Huh? No, say that again.
I
was saying they kicked me out. And I had to rejoin automatically.
Oh, okay. So tell me which one is better, this version of the
end is near.
Right.
And so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain.
Okay, that's kind of a sample. Which one? I gave a bit of my opinion. I feel the other one. Go ahead.
I mean, for the movie?
Yeah, just for the movie.
Definitely.
Play the one for the movie again.
Definitely.
Okay, this is the one for the movie.
Get to live the rest.
This is the normal one. I've lived. Which fits better?
The first one, the one that actually went to the movie.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
It's like more badass too.
Yeah, I feel like it fits more with both. Just like the mafia lifestyle, and like the idea of Scorsese was really trying to make the mafia lifestyle, like he was trying to stray away from the idea of like they're royal, that's kind of how it was portrayed in The Godfather, right? And he's trying to make them seem more badass, like they maybe not like badass in like the term, that in the sense that badass, these are some badass guys, like badass as in these are some pretty bad fellas rather than really good fellas, you know, because I'm a freaking cool, I know how to use words. So, you know, kind of like they're bad fellas. And I feel the other one just does a much better job with that. This one, if they had decided to go more into like just the glamorization all the way, and they didn't do like the whole coke spree and then him make his downfall and all that, it's possible that this one might fit. I still think the other one would fit in that situation. But I really do think that the original rendition of My Way is very far off from the tone of the film itself. Nebby?
Yeah?
Which one? The one they used or the other one?
Definitely this one.
All right.
I feel like it's going to be as clean as the other one.
Okay. That was kind of like the big thing that I wanted to talk about. Outside of that, as we've been, once again, when it comes to the Copacabana shot, the song used there, that's, I'll play it again, but I think it is maybe not perfect, but it is very, very good.
Thank you, sir. All right, see you later. Thanks.
What are you doing? You leaving your car?
What? It's a car for me. It's easier than leaving it at a garage and waiting. It's a lot quicker that way. You know what I mean?
Huh? That fits tonally with that. And once again, sometimes it seems that the words that the lyrics of the songs that Scorsese uses doesn't really match the tone of it. That is kind of a little bit of my problem with the parts of the Wolf of Wall Street score that doesn't work with me. Some of it is just like Scorsese just playing around and being like, I know this song, so let me throw it in. But here, this is a song about romance. It's him seducing the woman. It matches. And I think overall, as I'm thinking back through the songs, I want to retract my statement of that 80-20 thing. I actually do think that Scorsese's musical choices that at times work to his detriment work to his advantage in Goodfellas. And I that 20 that I was talking about, now that I'm really thinking back to it, I can't think of any bad choices in music. Nebby, if you have any bad choices in music in here, point them out. And I know you said your flaw with it is kind of like it was generic. I disagree that it's generic, because I mean, I can't really think of any other movies that use, first of all, Scorsese is pretty far from generic in his choices in music. They're very specific to him. He is very Rolling Stones, yeah. 70s. He is who he is. 60s probably, actually. And like that's kind of why I would disagree with the idea of the is genericity? Is there like a, what's the descriptive way of saying
generic?
Is there a way to say that? Genericity, the generosity. That is not, that's not the word that I was looking for, but that's why I would argue against it being generic. And I've actually kind of talked myself into thinking that it's a bit more not revolutionary, very fitting for the story itself. I actually didn't have a lot to say about the score, though. I had two bullet points here. You guys got anything else before we give our scores for the score?
I want some more static.
You want some more oomph to it, right? It just doesn't have enough oomph. No nominations for the score, which is understandable. Because I haven't looked much into it, but I feel like a good amount of the population probably has similar opinions to what I've been saying. Like, Scorsese is very Scorsese in his choices of music, and it might not work out the greatest in his favor at times. So, you guys want to give your scores for the score? Hey, scores for the score. How have I never thought of that before? I've done four episodes and I've never said that. All right. But last time, I believe Nebby went first. Billy would win last. So, Billy, you're first this time.
All right. I remember in our very first, not first, but first few podcasts that we did together, Nebby gave a score, and I'm going to give the same score, 2.5. He gave the score because he just didn't know. He just didn't know, like, what to put in. He didn't know enough about it. And I think this is what I got to do this time.
I want to need you to return to it, Billy, man, I need you to return to the sword, though. All right, I understand, though.
Okay. Actually, 2.5 is a little harsh. I don't think it was that bad. I'm going to say based on the scores that you pointed out, like right now, when you were talking. Mm-hmm. And because of those two, I think I want to bump it up to 3.5.
Mr. Nebby Yukiros, you're back.
Nebula.
Can you hear me? Out of five?
You're good now.
You're good.
Three?
I'm going to say, three.
I, as much as I would like to keep the streak of these, like, very highs, this is not going to be low, but I am going to go with a four.
Yeah, that's a second one. I think, like, your taste in music, too, works well.
Yeah, like I was saying, as even though I did retract on this, the whole 80-20 theory I had earlier, I think, like, my general concept of the film, like, I feel like 80% of it works for me and then 20% of it just doesn't, as compared to I know neither of you have seen this, and hopefully we this is, like, one of the chillest films out there, Dazed and Confused. I genuinely think that every song in that guy works for me. It's something that all of us have seen. Guardians of the Galaxy. Maybe not every song of it works for me, but I know at least like 90% of it works for me. That's kind of 80% of this, like, works directly towards me. The ones that I pointed out, I think those are like the high points, but I can't really think of the other points. I can't even say they were low points. I just can't think of them. I think that's kind of the reason why Nebby gave it a three. And altogether, that is a low so far with a 10.5 out of 15. But now we get into Payoff. And the only note I really have here for Payoff is actually something that has to do with just Scorsese as a director and, like, the types of movies he makes. In that all of his films are real. Like, all of this has happened in real life. Billy, what Scorsese have you seen?
Well, I don't always look at directors, but off the top of my head, Goodfellas, The Departed, Wolf of Wall Street, a long time ago, I think I saw The Taxi Driver, but I don't know. Actually, take that off. I might have not, but those three, and let me see. No, you think I watched Casino for sure.
Okay.
But nah, I didn't.
I think the rest of them are more like docs. You seen Shark Tale?
Shark Tale?
He was the blowfish in Shark Tale. That was him voicing him. Of the three.
Well, yo, hold up. Where is this?
Which one?
The song.
Oh, the song?
And Shark Tale is the fourth one.
Yeah, remember. Walking in the sand.
Yo, this is the song, though, like, that viral meme that come. Oh, no. Oh, no.
Oh, Nebby, this is the one that you're talking about.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Nebby, is this the song you're talking about? Oh, this is definitely... Yeah, this is the song that Nebby was referring to earlier.
Right.
But...
Nebby, I don't know what's going on with you, but...
Super laggy right now. But as I was saying, of the three that you've seen, the Wolf of Wall... Of the four. Well, he didn't direct Shark Tale, he was just kind of in it. So I'll count three. So... Okay, The Wolf of Wall Street and Goodfellas are clearly based in reality. And when it comes to The Departed, it was based off of a foreign film, but they incorporated Frank Costello was a real guy, and they incorporated a lot of him and like how he came down into that. So, as I said, Scorsese's universe, there's the MCU. We have the Middle Earth. Yeah, Lord of the Rings and Hobbits. You have Harry Potter. You have all of those big franchises. Even beyond that, you have some people argue that Tarantino's movies are all in one universe. But when it comes to Scorsese's movies, all of his movies are our universe. And when it comes to like the payoff of his stuff, I think he tries very hard to... Well, not tries very hard. He clearly gets across his viewpoint of our world.
Yeah, yeah.
Yo, what's up?
How long my battery's gonna last?
What's your battery?
Like 5. It's charging. I don't really have an option.
Right. Always talk about how iPhone battery. I always also talk about it, but you get on top of it. Like, what's wrong with your phone? Why is it always dying?
Why is your phone dying? You have an S9, right?
Yeah, S9.
If I'm ever on a call and charging at the same time, it charges faster than it's losing.
Yeah, I don't have the fast charger though. You gave me a.
I don't either. One.
Oh shoot! What the? I might fail with the key.
All right, but we don't have too much left. We have payoff, and then we kind of just get into the extra categories. Well, payoff wise, payoff shouldn't take too long.
Maybe just let me go first with the
answer. Yeah, definitely. For the payoff,
alright.
Nebby, go ahead and tell us why, and then give us your score, or give us your score and then tell us why.
Just amazing. It's out of 10, right?
It's out of 5. It's out of 5.
Oh, out of 5. Well, definitely. I mean, that's like, dang. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't like wild, but I was definitely wild. So. Maybe a 4.5 because I left really enjoying the movie, and it really was a great start to the Mafia franchises. If you ask me,
I'm gonna going to talk about this a little bit more when we get to the into the pantheon of all-time greats. I give it a 5 out of 5.
Oh.
I have literally no reason not to. Because I genuinely... Each time that I have gone into it and came out, I have come out with a new experience. Even knowing how great it is the first time going in, the second time going in, the third time going in, now the fourth time going in. I've been astounded each and every time. I found new things. This time, a lot of the things that I've talked about throughout this podcast so far is some... I'll say at least half of it is new stuff that I found as I was watching it this time. And I doubt that that will stop as I keep watching it later in the future. In the future. Billy.
I just bumped it up just like by hearing you and like think about it. I'm giving it a 5 out of 5. I don't get a 4.9 and use the... It's not the Godfather, you know. That's why I'm not giving it 5 out of 5. But I love this movie. The fact that,
said a 5. Oh, okay.
Yeah, I said I was gonna give it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but it's a true story, and I don't know. You ever been so like immersed in a movie that like so into a movie? That once it's over, you feel like you just came out of a different world. Like,
yes.
Yeah, like you're that's how I feel when you're in the movie theater. How you finish. Yeah.
Oh, definitely.
You get up, everybody's leaving. You completely forgot that there's a whole world out there and you were just like watching a movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly how I felt about this movie. And I remember this feeling too. Because it was right before... like I told you, our Knives Out podcast. Yeah, I remember I was watching it, and I got out. Like, oh, jump.
Oh, shoot, I got to record a podcast. That's a great explanation of this. I think we'll get into that once again with Pantheon and all-time greats. A lot of, like, the all-time greats have that effect. And I don't think you can really be an all-time great without having that effect. I think, in a sense, going back to movies I know you've seen, The Wolf of Wall Street has that effect to me, too. Where it's like, oh, shoot. I forgot that I'm not banging holes with Jordan Belfort. I have to live in this actual world. And back to here, it's like, oh, crap. I'm not a mobster. I'm not actually with these people. That's another great point from Billy Manishimwe. Alright, but you guys want to guess percentage scores, what you've given this movie? You can see like what the totals are, but percentages wise.
Wait, this is the final category?
Huh? Yeah, that was the final category. Payoff was the final category. What do you think you gave this out of 100? A percentage out of 100?
Out of 100. I feel like I was pretty harsh on this movie, if I'm not going to cap, but I feel like I might have gave it an 8 out of 10. Out of 100, right? 8 out of 100?
I mean, yeah, percentage. Just give me a percentage. Like, if you were at, like, Rotten Tomatoes, what would you think?
Definitely 80%.
You gave it an 83.125%, which is, like... What's wrong with you? Are you okay? Imagine if you searched up Goodfellas and you saw on Rotten Tomatoes that they gave it at 83%. You would have to boycott Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, I was exceptionally hard on this.
All right, Billy.
I don't really know why.
You want to guess?
I mean, I don't have a guess.
Oh, damn it, Billy.
Obviously, I could tell. I can do math and know that's 90%.
Damn it, Billy. Billy gave it a 90%, which is more respectable. And gave it a 93.13%. Okay, so with that, try not to do math. What do you think our combined cinema score, just our combined percentages?
87.
I'm going to try and make a guess just from looking. I'm going to say 84%.
88.75%. How do you feel about that, guys? In context to what we've given others, I actually think that's pretty good. And then I think, obviously, that's the highest so far. I think Rashomon's the second highest with maybe like an 81. Probably even lower than that. Rashomon did well, but maybe not like amazing. What I want to do for this one, though, and from here on, to give like a more perspective to our scores, I want each of us to give it a letter grade. You know, because I think it's easier to wrap our minds around just like a letter grade rather than this numerical score, which can seem sort of arbitrary at times. I guess I'll start off. and I mean, I have to give it an A plus because it is an A plus movie. And it's kind of like just with my payoff score. I don't see any reason not to give it that A plus. And that's pretty much my reasoning. There's no reason to not give it that. It could possibly slip into an A, but I think it's an A plus. Billy?
I'm gonna give it an A.
I'm gonna give it an A also. It's definitely an A movie, but
once you guys have seen it four times, if you don't think it's A plus, like you the liberal, okay. I actually think that okay. There are two movies that I've recently seen that I think are kind of like a personality test to see if I would get along with, maybe not get along with the person, but if my friendship will last with the person. Have either of you seen Con Air?
When you say Con Air, I think about the razor brand.
But no, if you guys have never seen that movie, that is like the most hilariously bad movie that is really good. And I mean, like, Nebby, I know you've seen The Room, and The Room is just like clearly bad, right? Con Air is like I can understand if somebody like genuinely says it's good, but it's also bad, and I think it knows it's bad, but it's so good. That's the first one. It's just like, if you don't find that enjoyable, maybe not necessarily good, enjoyable, I don't think my personality would probably match. You know, I genuinely believe both Billy and Nebby would find that enjoyable. Con Air, you would find that movie enjoyable. It's freaking hilarious. And when it comes to Goodfellas, I can understand somebody not liking Goodfellas.
What?
But whoever doesn't like Goodfellas should not come around me. No, I mean, like, as a human being, everybody has opinions, right?
Yeah.
In that sense, I can't, like, understand it, like, as you having a good opinion. Like, if you don't like Goodfellas, I'm going to assume that you're, like, psychopathically deranged or something, you know?
If you don't like Goodfellas, I'm going to assume you one of the people that, like, not just, like, prefer reading a book, but like hates watching movies and prefer.
Bro, I absolutely. Whoever says that just doesn't make sense. Anybody that says either reading a book or watching a painting is so much better than watching a movie. I mean, for the most part, the movie's a combination of both.
Exactly. And make sure you watch out for the time.
Unless you are blind, I can't understand you're not watching, not liking movies. And even if you are blind.
Oh, yeah. everything gonna be all right this morning. Oh yeah. Young boy, at the age of 5, my mother's child gonna be